Hello students, in this video we will learn how to solve tilting edge problems in eccentrically loaded riveted joints. We will begin by understanding what is meant by tilting edge in a riveted joint and then look at designing the rivets. So let's move on to the next slide. This is the problem that we will be solving. If I will read it, determine the diameter of rivet for a bracket riveted as shown. The allowable normal and shear stresses are 120 Newton per millimeter square and 60 Newton per millimeter square respectively. A force of 25 kilonewton acts as shown in figure. So here what we are trying to do is, they have asked us to design or they have asked us to determine the diameter of the rivet. Okay, therefore our objective is to find out diameter of the rivet for a bracket that is riveted as shown in the figure. Now if you see, maybe this we can consider it to be a wall. Okay, so like we have a wall, I will name the wall as a plate 1, and we have a bracket here. I will number it as 2. Therefore the bracket is fixed onto the wall using 3 rivets. Now in this particular view, let's say that this is the front view. Okay, this is the front view and this is the side view, right? Now when you look at the bracket from the front, we can see that the bracket is fixed onto the wall using 3 rivets, 1, 2, and 3. The rivets number 1 and 3 are along the same horizontal line, right? Now, we also assume that all the three rivets are of equal size. That is, the diameter of rivets for all three, for all the three points are same, okay? Now, other information that you will get from this figure is that we see that rivet number 1 and 3 are at an height of L1 from the bottom of the bracket. Okay, and this particular point that I am highlighting here, this is the point that we call as tilting edge. All right, this is the tilting edge, and this point is the pivot about which the bracket may tilt when you apply the force, right? Now this and if you will look at the force here, the force is acting at a distance of 1200 mm from the tilting edge. Okay, that is, from the tilting edge the line of action of the force is 1200 mm. Force is at a distance of 1200 mm from the line of action. Now, if you will note here, according to the figure, L1 and L3, that is distance of rivets 1 and 3 from the tilting edge, is 200 plus 100, 300 mm, right? Therefore, L1 is equal to L3, distance of the rivets from the tilting edge as seen in the figure is 300 mm. Okay, and L2, which is distance of rivet 2 from the tilting edge as seen in the figure, is 100 mm. Okay, therefore L2 is 100 mm. Okay, so what happens now is, when this load of 25 kilonewton, okay, when this 25 kilonewton load is eccentrically acting, that is acting at a distance of 1200 mm, it will cause the bracket to tilt, isn't it? Now it is this tilt which the rivet is preventing. Okay, the fact that we have used proper rivets will prevent this tilt of the bracket. Okay, now Let us look at the line of action of the forces in the next slide. All right, so now let us look at the forces that are in play in this riveted joint. We have the applied force P equal to 25 kilonewton acting vertically downwards here. Okay, now this a force of 25 kilonewton is resisted by all the three rivets 1, 2, and 3. Okay, therefore the total load of 25 kilonewton will be shared by rivets 1, 2, and 3. Okay, now that resisting force is your primary shear force. Okay, therefore let me just calculate that here. Therefore primary shear force is equal to the force, I just denote it by F1 dash equal to F2 dash equal to F3 dash. Okay, that is resisting force generated by all the three rivets against the applied force of 25 kilonewton. Now it will be equally shared. P will be shared equally between all three rivets. Therefore, this is equal to applied load divided by number of rivets, which in this particular case is equal to 3. Therefore, it is 25 into 10 power 3 divided by 3, which is equal to, let me just check, 8333. This is equal to 8333.33 newton. Okay, therefore, this is the primary shear force that is developed in all the three rivets. Okay, now in addition to this, there will be something known as secondary shear force. Secondary shear force. Okay, now what is the secondary shear force? Now this secondary shear force is because this applied load of 25 kilonewton is also causing a moment equal to P into eccentricity E. That is 25 kilonewton into eccentricity. Eccentricity is this perpendicular distance between the load and the tilting edge. Okay, that is 1200 mm. Therefore, this is the moment that will cause the bracket to tilt. Okay, and this tilting is opposed by the rivets. Why? Because the rivets also will develop resisting moments. Okay, and these secondary forces will be acting opposite to the direction of tilt. Okay, if the bracket is going to tilt to the right side, the resisting force will be towards the left. Therefore, at this height where you have rivets 1 and 3, you will be having secondary forces F1 double dash and F3 double dash. Similarly, at the height of rivet 2, we will be having secondary forces F2 double dash. All right, therefore we have three secondary forces F1 double dash, F2 double dash and F3 double dash that are developed in the rivets. Okay, therefore each of the rivet will be subjected to two forces, that is primary shear force, which will be equal to 8333.33, plus a secondary shear force. Okay, or I just call it as shear force is equal to F1 double dash, F2 double dash and F3 double dash. Now our task will be to find out the magnitude of these secondary forces F1 double dash, F2 double dash and F3 double dash. Okay, now we will see that in the next slide. Okay, so now let's find the secondary forces F1 double dash, F2 double dash and F3 double dash. Okay, now if you remember the riveted joint, if I will look at it from the front view, you have three rivets that joins the bracket to the wall, isn't it? Okay, now this is three rivets. This is rivet number 1, this is 3 and this is 2. Okay, now each of these rivets is subjected to secondary force. Okay, now if you remember this edge, is what we mean by a tilting edge, right? You had seen it in the previous slide. This is the tilting edge. That is, if you will look at it from this side view, this is the wall, and on the wall we have the bracket. Okay, and this edge, this is the edge that you see here. Okay, all right. Now what happens here is the distance of the rivets from the tilting edge. So suppose if this is the height of rivet number 2, and this here is the height of rivet 1 and 3, then the ratio of secondary forces to the distance is a fixed value. Okay, because it's a symmetrical like arrangement. Okay, therefore F1 double dash by L1, that is L1 will be from here till this height. Now this is L1, okay, and this is L2. Okay, therefore F1 double dash by L1, this is equal to F2 double dash divided by L2, and this is equal to F3 double dash divided by L3. This is equal to a fixed value. Let's say that it is C. Okay, therefore the ratio of secondary forces to the distance from the tilting edge is equal to a fixed value C. All right, therefore you can actually say that therefore F1 double dash is equal to C times L1. Okay, and F2 double dash is equal to C times L2, and F3 double dash is equal to C into L3. All right, so this is how the forces are split. Okay, now let us look at the moments now. Okay, let us look at the moments. Now the applied force, if you look, remember the force was acting here, isn't it? The applied force of 25 kilonewton was acting at a distance of 1200 mm. Okay, therefore applied moment is equal to P into E. Applied moment is equal to P and E, and this moment is resisted by moments due to these three secondary forces. Okay, now what are the secondary moments? What is the secondary moment of rivet 1? It will be F1 double dash force into perpendicular distance from the tilting edge, which is L1. Okay, similarly a resisting moment at rivet 2 will be F2 double dash into L2. Okay, plus resisting moment at rivet 3 will be F3 double dash into L3. Okay, therefore if the rivets are supposed to hold the rivet, if the rivets are supposed to resist the applied force of 25 kilonewton, this moments should be balanced. Applied moments should be balanced by the resisting moments. Okay, now from this relationship we can find the value of the secondary forces F1 double dash, F2 double dash and F3 double dash. How do we do that? It's because now I know that F1 double dash is equal to C times L1. Okay, therefore I can rewrite this as C into L1 into L1 plus F2 will become C into L2 into L2 plus F3 will become C into L3 into L3, right? Or this can be further like expressed as equal to c into l1 square plus c into l2 square plus c into l3 square. Okay, because l1 into like l1, l2 into l2, and l3 into like l3 will become their squares. Okay, now let me rewrite this. All right, so if I will rewrite it, I will get p into e, which is the applied moment, is equal to the resisting moment, which is c into l1 square plus c into l2 square plus c into l3 square. Okay, now if you remember the figure, l1 and l2 was same, isn't it? L1 and L2 was at the same height. Therefore, L1 equal to L3. Okay. Therefore, I can rewrite this as 2 times C into L1 square, right? Plus C into L2 square. Because L1 is equal to L3. Okay. And this is equal to P into E. Okay. So, what I can now do is, I can therefore say that the value of C is equal to, if I will take C outside as common and then write an equation for C, it will become P into E divided by P into E divided by, if I take C outside as common, this will become 2 times L1 square plus L2 square. This is the value of C. All right, now what I can do is, we know that f1 double dash is equal to c times l1, isn't it? C times like l1. Okay, now c value is here. Now if I substitute for c here, if I substitute for c, f1 double dash will become C is P into E, and I will multiply by this L1 divided by denominator is 2 times L1 square plus L2 square. Now I have a formula for F1. Similarly, what will be F2 double dash? F2 double dash will be equal to C into L2, which will be equal to P E L2 divided by 2 times L1 square plus L2 square. Okay, and in the same way, F3 double dash will be equal to C times L3, which is equal to P E L3 divided by 2 times L1 square plus L3 square. Okay, so in general, secondary forces can be denoted as Fn double dash is equal to P times E into Ln divided by 2 times, it will be L1 square plus L3 square, sorry, L2, sorry, Ln square. Sorry, let me just change that. I made a mistake there. Let me try to remove this. It will become 2 times L1 square plus Ln square. All right, so this formula you can remember. Okay, you need not derive all this equation if you are solving the problem. Okay, I just derive this for your understanding. You can directly go to the directly use this equation and solve the problem. Okay, now we will find out the secondary forces for this particular problem in the next slide. Okay, therefore we have already obtained primary forces F1 dash, F2 dash, and F3 dash as, just a second, let me, F3 dash as equal to 8333.33 Newton. Now we will find out secondary forces. The formula we now know, F1 double dash will be equal to F3 double dash, right? F3 double dash, and because L3 and L1 are equal, okay, therefore this becomes equal to P into E divided PE L1. Let me just find out for L1. PE L1 divided by 2 times L1 square plus L2 square. Okay, and this is equal to how much? P is 25 into 10 power 3. Eccentricity is 1200 into L1 was 300 mm divided by 2 times 300 square plus L2 was 100 square. All right. So how much is this value now? Therefore, this becomes equal to let me just calculate that. 25 10 power 3 into 1200 into 300 divided by 2 into 300 square plus 100 square. Right, it comes to Forty-seven thousand three sixty-eight point. Let me just write it down here. 47,368.42 newton. All right. So this was F1 double dash, which will be equal to F3 double dash. Okay. Now let's find out F2 now. All right. So let's find out F2 double dash. F2 double dash will be PE L2 divided by 2 times L1 square plus L2 square, and this becomes 25 into 10 power 3 into 1200 into L2. L2 was 100 mm divided by 2 times 300 square plus 100 square. Okay, and this is equal to, let me just find the value, 25 10 power 3 into 1200 into 100 divided by 2 into 300 square plus 100 square, which is equal to 15,789.47 newton. Okay, now we have the two secondary forces with us. Okay, now we know the forces, we can now go ahead and design the rivet. That we will do it in the next slide. Okay, so now we have with us the primary shear force and the secondary normal force. Okay, so we have so far obtained direct shear force F1 dash equal to F2 dash equal to F3 dash, and this we have calculated as 8,333.33 newton, and the secondary normal forces F1 double dash, which was equal to F3 double dash, because they both rivets 1 and 3 are on the same line, and this force we have obtained it as 47,368.42 newton in the previous slide, and we have obtained F2 double dash secondary normal force or rivet 2 as 15,789.47 newton. Okay, so these are the forces that are acting on the rivets, and now we see that the direct shear force on all the three rivets are equal, whereas the secondary normal forces are higher in rivet 1 and 3 and lower in rivet 2. Okay, therefore we can directly say that rivets 1 and 3 are heavily loaded, right? The load acting on heavily loaded. Okay, therefore the load that is acting on rivets 1 and 3 are much greater than that of load acting on rivet 2. Okay, therefore what we can do is we will design for rivets 1 and 3, and we can ignore rivet number 2. Okay, all right. So now let us look into the stresses. Okay, let's look at step 3, where we will do the stress analysis. Okay, we will do the stress analysis. Now, it was mentioned in the problem that permissible normal stress or allowable normal stress is 120 Newton per millimeter square, and allowable shear stress is equal to 60 Newton per millimeter square. Okay, now we know the forces that are acting on the rivets. Okay, and we know what is the maximum stress that can be induced. Okay, therefore we need to find the diameter of the rivet such that the stresses induced are not more than 120 normal or 60 shear. All right, okay, so now let's first calculate what is direct shear stress acting. Okay, what is direct shear stress acting on the rivets? Now this we know that shear stress again is equal to force by area. Okay, the shear force that is acting is 8333.33 Newton. Okay, so I will write this equation for shear stress as 8333.33 divided by area A. Okay, I call this as equation 1. Now this holds good for both rivets 1 and rivets 3. Okay, remember we are going to design for only heavily loaded rivets, which are rivets number 1 and 3. Okay, now therefore this is the formula for direct shear stress. All right, now we will look at the normal stress formula in the next slide. All right, now normal stresses, suppose if this is a rivet, okay, and in the previous slide we saw that the shear stress that's acting is equal to 8333.33 by area. Okay, now normal stress is because of the normal force that acts here, okay, which we have denoted as F1 double dash, F2 double dash and F3 double dash. Okay, therefore normal stress is find out for sigma 1, which is equal to sigma 3, right? Because both rivets 1 and rivets 3 are on the same line, and this is equal to normal force either F1 double dash, or you can go for F3 also, okay, or F3 double dash divided by area A. Okay, now we have obtained F1 double dash and F3 double dash as 47,368.42 divided by area A. Right, so this is the equation for normal stresses. I will name it as equation 2. Okay, so now we have a rivet which is subjected to both normal stresses and shear stresses acting simultaneously, okay, which is the case of compound stress, isn't it, which we have studied from mechanics of materials itself. And even in this design of machine elements 1 unit 1 also we have studied compound stresses. Therefore, when there is both shear and normal stresses acting simultaneously, to obtain the maximum stress, we will have to find out maximum normal stress, which is nothing but the principal stress, isn't it? Right? Which is nothing but the principal stress. Okay, maximum stress, which is nothing but the principal stress. And principal stress formula we know is given by sigma x by sigma y by 2 plus or minus root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau square. Okay, now this is the full equation for principal stresses, which will be the maximum normal stress. But in this particular case, we know that sigma y is equal to 0 because there is no load acting in the y direction, right? Therefore, this will simplify to sigma x by 2, and I will not take the minus value here. Why? Because we are finding out the maximum normal stress. Therefore, I'll be happy with the major principal stress value. Therefore, I will stick to only plus root of sigma x by 2 whole square. Sigma y is equal to 0. Therefore, it becomes sigma x by 2 whole square plus tau square. All right. Now, if I will substitute the value of sigma x, which is nothing but your sigma 1 or sigma 3. All right. Therefore, this is the from equation 2. Therefore, from equation 2. If I will substitute this, maximum normal stress is equal to sigma x, which is 47,368.42 divided by 2 plus root of 47,368.42 divided by it is sigma x, is there is a A here, okay, we should not miss this. Therefore, it is A into 2, okay. Here also it becomes A into 2 whole square plus shear stress square, okay. Shear stress is the direct shear stress for which we have got 8,333.33 divided by A whole square. Okay, now this is the formula for maximum normal stress. Okay, now I will simplify this and I will get a formula for maximum normal stress. Okay, this I will do it in the next slide. All right, so if you will simplify the above formula, I will get the maximum normal stress as equal to 48,791.7 divided by A. Okay, if I will simplify the principal stress formula, this is what I get. Okay, now this is the maximum normal stress. Okay, therefore, according to normal stress. Theory, okay, the allowable normal stress should be less than or equal to maximum normal stress, okay, or the normal stress, the allowable stress was specified as 120 in the problem statement, 120 newton per millimeter square, or this is equal to 48,791.7 divided by A. Okay, or if you will solve for area is equal to you will get area is equal to 406.597. Okay, now area of the rivet we know is pi d square by 4 because rivets are circular. Now you can solve for D. Okay, Now solve for D and you will get diameter as 22.75 mm. Right? So this is the diameter of the rivet, right? According to normal stress theory. Okay. Now they have also asked us, we should also take into account maximum shear stress also. Okay. Because they say that the maximum induced shear stress should not be greater than 60. All right. Therefore, according to maximum shear stress theory, let me just draw a line here and take it to the right. Now, according to maximum shear stress theory. Okay. Now we know that maximum shear stress is given by plus or minus root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau square, right? Now sigma y is 0 and sigma x value we like already have, and shear stress value also we know. Okay, so if you will simplify this, we will get maximum shear stress as equal to 25,107.49 divided by area, right? So this is what we get according to maximum shear stress theory, right? Now it is given that allowable shear stress. Okay, just a second, I made a notation error here. Just a second. This is maximum normal stress theory, therefore it will be allowable normal stress. It is sigma allowable. Okay, all right. Now according to shear stress, the maximum permissible shear stress was less than or equal to 60 newton per millimeter square. Okay, therefore 60 is equal to 25,107.49 divided by A. Okay, therefore A becomes, if you will solve for A, it becomes 418.46, okay, which is equal to pi d square by 4. Therefore solve for diameter and you get diameter as 23.08 millimeters, right? Therefore, according to both normal stress theory and shear stress theory, we have got diameters as 22.75 or 23.08 mm, like according to maximum shear stress. Now, which value do we need to take? We should always go for the larger value, isn't it? Because if we take the small value, then the rivet might fail due to maximum shear stress. Right, therefore we need to choose the higher value. All right, therefore preferred diameter of the rivet, therefore preferred diameter of rivet D equal to 23.08 millimeters. Now you can use your design data handbook, okay, and select the standard value of rivet from table. Okay, standard value of rivet can be obtained from the table, and that I believe is 24 mm. Okay, have a look at the handbook. All right, so that solves the problem. If I have to summarize this problem, we began by finding out the direct shear forces F1 dash, F2 dash and F3 dash, and then we will find out the secondary shear forces to balance the tilting moment, which was F1 double dash, F2 double dash and F3 double dash. Now from this we saw that F1 and F3 are heavily loaded rivets because the force that acts on F1 and F3 is equal, and significantly greater than the force that acts on rivet number 2. Okay, therefore we will focus our designs on rivet 1 and 3. Then what we do is we will use both maximum normal stress, which is nothing but principal stress, and we will find out maximum shear stress. All right, allowable normal stress and allowable shear stresses are given in the problem statement. So by like equating these stress values, we will find the diameter. All right, so I hope you have understood the problem. If you have any doubts or need more clarifications, please do contact me. Okay, thank you. Bye bye.